Wednesday is the Lutheran social at 11:30. Wednesday also is worship and music at 12:30. And 5:30 will be finance. Okay? Don't forget about Saturday. It's the St. Patty's potluck. If you haven't signed up and would like to attend, please do. Bring a dish that you can share with everybody. There will also be bingo. Okay? The March outreach is Laundry Love. So if you want to make a donation there to help feed the washers, dryers, washers and dryers, or volunteer your time to go over and help too. You're welcome to do that too as well. We still have some long sleeve shirts over in the parish house, so if anybody's interested in the long sleeve shirts, we have them. We have a few short sleeve, and the word for the short sleeve, I put back up. Pastor Joel was able to get us the same pricing that we had when we made the first order, so I put that back up. So if anybody's interested in ordering a short sleeve shirt, the sign-up's back there, okay, or the order form, okay? The polo order forms are back there also with the pricing on it. If you'd like to get one of those, there's two different kinds. One's more of a nylon fabric, and the other one's a cotton. So just make sure you, if you want one of those, you get the right order form, okay? We have traditional communion next Sunday. Anybody that doesn't want to come up and do the normal communion where you can come up front, you're still welcome to take the little, what do you call them, the creamer, the little cup or whatever, okay? So that's going to start next week, okay? Don't forget all the committee chairmen for each of the committees. Please remember to go in and put your meeting and times on that big calendar, if you would, please, on the bulletin board. Kind of helps us to keep that thing going so we get in a regular routine call. We have an event coming up here in April, and it's Habitat for Humanity. There's three weekends. Well, it'll be a Thursday, Friday, and a Saturday starting on April 4th. We have an opportunity to do something here, provide either a snack or a meal. The snack date for that that's available for us will be April 5th, and then the meal will be on April 12th. They want us to try to provide for up to 20 people. So if that's something we're interested in, I would say maybe it could be a good outreach thing, or if we want to make donations to put food together or whatever. Let's think about that. It would be some good for the church too. Habitat for Humanity, have some pictures and things to go on our website or wherever, Facebook. I think that would all be good. So, yes.
Give us a little more information. What exactly?
We're building a home. I think it's a small home. Is that correct, Pastor?
There's actually, there are two homes, like a duplex. Duplex. That they're building a focus lab this week. And it's on Lumber, near Lumber Street. And I haven't been there by the site, near Lumber Street. And Littlestown. They have three, it's called the Blitz Build with Habitat. They do it over three weekends and get as much done as they can. They can only handle up to 20 workers, so like light hammer nails and framing and drywalling, or even if you can't, you're not skilled. They can look for people who they need runners, like people bringing the drywall over, go get a 2x4. And it's an excellent opportunity to spend a day working with other Christians and meeting other people. And I was very involved in it. In Southern California, Habitat, met people from all over the world. We had the Blitz Build there in Long Beach. I think we had 20 to 30 homes we built over a couple, like a month. And so it's an opportunity. And how it came about, generally speaking, I won't go into too belabor too much, but Adams County Habitat is building these homes. They happen to be in Littlestown. So they were looking for churches in Adams County to participate in providing a meal and or a snack. And it's a lunch. So it's sandwiches, a bag of chips,
okay,
a drink, something simple that you can give to the workers on site.
So a question with that, would we be better off donating that than having somebody go to Sam's Club and find a bowl?
Well, they're looking for people, churches, to actually serve it too. There'll be tables and a tent, pop-up tent. That you can have bags, lunch bags. Think about working in that on site all day. At 10 o'clock, they're going to take a break for a brief snack, and 2 hours later, they're going to have lunch. So you have a sandwich, a bag of chips, a chooses, but something quick and easy, they can just hand to the worker and they can go find a place to sit and have lunch. So it's not a production, it's not like William Lasagna or serving something hot. It's something quick and easy that you can just put in a paper bag or something that, and they can take and run with it. Does that help?
And then if you want to work, you want to help and actually build or frame, you know, do some of the work, it goes, the hours are from 8 o'clock in the morning till 2 p.m. Okay? So
that requires a waiver to be on site to work. They cap it at 20 people. Again, it's a small site, so they can't do 50 people at a time. So they're limited in the number, and not everyone will be there every day. So if you want to make it one day, let us know, and we'll be able to see if there's a spot available on that day. I know, say, at Littlestown, as an example, one of the members there gets a day off from his work if he's volunteering somewhere. It's part of their company plan. Some people may be able to take a day off work. Some people who can't, then maybe a Saturday might be a good time for them to visit. But as far as the meal and the snack, at this point, those are the only two dates that are available to us, because other churches have committed.
And we would just have to get it together as soon as possible to let them know, because the 1st of April is coming pretty quick. So if we're going to participate in one of them, decide what you want to do, if it's a snack or lunch, and then we got to get with committees and figure out what and when and who's all going to go and all that to serve.
So should we make a decision now? So that
let's do it after church. That way we can get things rolling here a little bit. Anyone interested in knowing more about it or wanting to be a part of it in any way, maybe we can just meet in Sunday school room behind there after service. That would be great. Okay. Any other announcements? Anything I missed? Linda? The sign up sheets for worship, our communion assistant, and altar giver. They're posted through the end of the summer. They're back on the bulletin board where all the other order forms and stuff like that is. Only one question that did come up about that. Some people were asking, do we want to put up for the whole year? So somebody wants a specific month to do something.
Well, I'm going to do it through the end of the summer, and then we'll
do, the rest of it. Okay. So if you're interested in doing that, please sign up for that. I know we have a lot of volunteers and people that are interested for the Altar Guild and to do the communion assistant. That's a good thing. So any other announcements? Well, let's start with prayer with them.
writes the law on our hearts and draws all people together through Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak in ways that silence others. We are silent when we should speak up. We keep score in our hearts. We let curse grow into hatred. For all these things and for sins only you know. Forgive us. Here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life through Jesus the Christ.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. By the humiliation of your Son, you lifted up this fallen world.
Lead us into your light, that all our deeds may reflect your love. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The second reading is from Ephesians chapter 2, 1 through 10. You were dead through the trespasses and sins in which you lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now in work among those who are disobedient. All of us lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of the flesh and the senses, and were by nature children of wrath, like everyone else. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, he made us alive again in Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated with us in him, the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Jesus Christ. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus
Jesus said, just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light, and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. Jesus brings light and life to those who believe in him, but not to those who refuse to come to the light. Well, I'm glad you made it in this morning despite the time change. We've got the whole Lawyer family here too this morning. That's a special treat. And if anyone is having trouble staying awake, Dwight has a special bugle call for you. And for those of you who have after the sermon have trouble staying awake, that's the part, if you may have noticed, stand on our heads, too. So, or actually read backwards like this Hebrew, and we get a good experience of the cultural exchange. So we thought of everything this morning to try to keep you engaged. And even myself, even a more engaging sermon maybe than usual. I don't know. We'll see. Well, it's been quite a week for all of us on many levels, and I do want to bring greetings to you from Dave and by extension Sue, who I was able to visit this week down in Baltimore. And as many of you probably know, any trip to Baltimore is a real trip, a real adventure. And Sue's been at the University of Maryland Medical Center, which is in the heart of the Inner Harbor area. Lots of construction going on, which always makes it a wonderful trip, and finding parking and then getting to the hospital. But I had a wonderful visit with Sue. I think she was really encouraged. And I spoke with Dave this morning. He's very encouraged also about the prospects. And they started talking while I was there, one of the case workers and case managers. And Dave confirmed that they're talking about her coming back here to at least to a rehab in York County or Adams County. So that will be much improved. And we'll talk about this afterwards. I mean, if you have any questions, we can update. So besides that, this week, in the middle of that traveling, in the middle of, on 695, I'm getting text about a funeral to do for First John, or yeah, for St. John's. And that's always fun on 695, trying to text and drive. All our cars give us all these notices, you know, through our phones, but makes it interesting. And so whatever I had planned for this week was quite, ended up being quite different. Also, besides the funeral, which I had on Friday for one of the First John's former members or members, we also had, did I say First John's? St. John's. Maybe we should just change it to First John's and St.
Luther.
But, and also this week, what else we have this week besides the funeral? Oh, also the Blitz building. That conversation started this week. So, trying to keep up with what's going on and to share that with you is always a challenge. Well, in the midst of this week, you know, the family requested that John 3:16 and the verse before that be the object of a meditation or a thought during the funeral. So everyone pretty much, I can assume, who might be here today, maybe I'm making a wrong assumption, but we all know, we've all seen John 3:16, even if we never made it through the door of the church. We probably saw it behind home plate at some baseball game or on a fence along the highway somewhere, or a billboard. But it's probably one of the most beloved verses of the Bible. And people, this morning after I shared it, said, yes, that's the one I want at my funeral too. So it says it all on some level, but not completely. There is a follow-up, there's a context. So everyone knows, for God so loved the world. And when I read it this morning, I read it with a different rhythm, because we often read it the same rhythm, don't we? For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. We kind of roll it, let it roll off our tongues and say it all in one breath. And it is just one verse. And we owe it to ourselves, though, to see the context. Because in the earlier verses, Jesus is talking to Nicodemus, and he uses an Old Testament story to explain the necessity of the cross and the new life that the cross makes available to us in the 21st century. And then there is the part that comes after John 3:16. After saying that God loved the world and sent his Son to give eternal life, Jesus goes on to say, "For God did not send his Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world should be saved through him." Of course, God didn't send the Son to condemn, but to save. But Jesus continues, "He who believes in him is not judged, and he who doesn't believe has been judged already, because he has not believed in the name of the one and only Son of God." So the fact that Jesus didn't come to judge, but there is still judgment. We're not without the judgment. But that was not Jesus' purpose, his main purpose. And that's harder for us to appreciate, because I think we like it when Jesus tells us that he loves the whole world and came to save us, and we're done with it. We don't like it when he says that some are condemned because of their failure to believe. That's exclusive. That leaves people out. In our current culture, we don't like that. We don't like it when he says that some of the condemned are condemned because of their failure to believe. Perhaps that's true. We prefer Jesus, though, and his message. Let's call it shrink wrap. Like meat, for example, at a supermarket. And I use this example at St. John's, and I know we had someone who cut meat at a market, so he could identify with this image. When we go to the supermarket, we enjoy the pretty shrink wrap packages and aren't much interested in how they got there, unless you're a farmer or you raise animals and know that. A lot of kids don't know what that means these days. Many years ago, correct me if I'm wrong, but I think you'll agree, it was unusual to walk into a meat department and not see a drawing of a cow on the wall that had all the cuts that were labeled for you to order. There was a part where you get round steaks, there's a part where you got T-bones, so forth. There'd be a hog, too. I haven't seen one of those in many years in our meat departments. At some point, the people who run the supermarkets learn that we don't really want to know the anatomy of the cow and how it relates to our meat that's nice and neatly packaged. We just want to buy that pretty package and take it home and fix dinner, and not know the whole story. And so it is, I think, with Jesus this morning. We want to know that he came to save the world, but we're not so interested in the rest of the story. The part about judging, the part about condemnation. But Jesus is as clear about the condemned part as he was about the saved part. Jesus is saying that you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. Now, not many of us probably have horses, but it might apply to other animals as well. You might have never seen a horse refuse to drink, but many of you have children, and you know exactly. exactly, you may have exactly known what your child needed, made it available, tried to provide, persuaded the child to take it, only to have the child stubbornly refuse. Sound familiar? If you haven't been a parent, if you've been a parent more than 30 minutes, you know exactly what that means. Jesus says that he came to save the world, but some people just don't want to be saved. He said that they love darkness rather than the light because their deeds are evil. They don't want to come to the light unless their evil deeds are exposed. Again, we prefer not to think about people like this, but we must admit that they do exist. They are, in this world, people who prefer darkness to light, who prefer evil to good. And if you don't believe this, talk to any police officer. You can find an experienced police officer who feels free to talk. He'll tell you stories that might curl your toes. But you don't have to talk to a police officer. You can read it in your newspaper or the television and any of the news shows. The stories are there. All you have to do is read them. Stories about evil people, people who love darkness rather than light. And Jesus tells us that these people are condemned. They are condemned because they will not come to the light. The opportunity is there, but they refuse. So while we would prefer to believe that all people are good, down deep we understand that that's not true. And while we would like to think that Jesus has saved everyone, we see all around us evidence that he has not. While we would like to believe that God would overlook the sins even of the unrepentant, there is still something in our hearts that cries out for accountability and for justice. There's a book that came out a few years ago called Among the Heroes, and it tells the story of the people on Flight 93, the plane that crashed into the field in western Pennsylvania on 9/11. And that flight, of course, was hijacked, and it would have been targeted, we understand, the White House or the Capitol building, had it not been for the efforts of the passengers and the crew. And there's a story in the book that speaks to that idea of righteous accountability, the righteous of some being saved and others being condemned. And the story had to do with a man named Tom Burnett, who was one of the passengers. He was bright, successful, married, had three young daughters. And he was an integral part of that group that tried to overtake the plane and save it. Tom and his group were not fully successful, of course, as we know, and the plane crashed and everyone on board was killed. But they were partially successful in that they prevented the hijackers from ramming the plane into the White House or Capitol building. And after the plane had crashed and the funerals had been held, Tom's daughters were terribly affected by his death. We don't often hear this story. They wouldn't let their mother out of their sight, and if she went to the mailbox, they wanted to go with her. And when they went to the park, they would ask, "Do you think any bad people are there?" At school, they would break down and cry. One of the girls asked her mother, "Are the bad people in heaven with Dad? If they're in heaven, are they going to hurt him again?" Are the bad people in heaven with Dad? And if they are they going to hurt him again? And I don't relate this story as a way of pronouncing judgment, because that's God's concern, not mine. But I relate it as a way of reminding us that there is something very right about Jesus pronouncing judgment on people who love darkness because their deeds are evil, who hate the light, who refuse to come to the light, lest their evil deeds are exposed. So there is something very right about our not having to spend eternity in their presence. So what I'd like for you to take home with you today is, for one thing, I'd like you to remember once again the beautiful verse of John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. This is a promise that God loves the world, all of us, you and me. And that's the good news. And then I'd like to dispel the notion that everyone is beautiful in their own way, which is a lovely sentiment from a song many years ago, but not necessarily true.
There are people who are not lovely because they love darkness because their deeds are evil. And then I'd like to challenge you to live your life in the light of Christ, to examine yourself to find the dark corners that you are trying to hide from Christ, so that you might open your heart fully to receive the light of Christ. For if you do that, it will change your life. It won't necessarily be an easy experience, but you, once you're on that other side, living fully in the light of Christ, you'll be glad you did. I'd like to share a quote from Victor Hugo in Les Miserables, and some may be familiar with that. He writes, "If there is anything more poignant than a body agonizing for want of bread, it is a soul which is dying of hunger for light." Where do we find that light? I hope that's one of your questions in your own soul this morning. I'd like to challenge you to be a bearer of Christ's light to your family, to your community, friends and neighbors, co-workers. I'm not saying corner people and say, "Do you know Jesus?" I'm suggesting something quite different, that you open yourself so fully to the light of Christ that you become a beacon of light, a beacon of faith, a beacon of integrity. You may be familiar with this quote, but it's worth repeating, attributed to St. Francis. "Preach the gospel at all times, and if necessary, use words." Let Christ this morning change the way you think about people, the way you relate to them. Let Christ change your language, the way you talk to people. Let Christ change the way you make decisions so that you're always trying to do the right thing rather than the easy thing. Christ shining through you will have great effect. Henry Nouwen wrote this. "The great mystery of the Christian life is that while we ourselves are overwhelmed by our own weaknesses and limitations, that we can still be so transparent that the Spirit of God, the divine counselor, shine through us and bring light to others." That is my hope for us this morning as we enter another week of serving God and loving each other.
Thank you.
to reconcile all things. Let us pray for the church, the well-being of creation, and the world in need. Gracious God, your love unites. Give vision to the global church and foster cooperation in the nation. Make your church a sanctuary for all fleeing persecution, disaster, war, and all areas of crisis. Hear us, O God. Creating God, your love enlivens. Restore the balance to the earth's fragile habitats. Preserve the wilderness lands, rainforests, and wildlife. Cleanse oceans, rivers, and all of our local water sources. Make us good stewards of the earth. Hear us, O God. Righteous God, your love liberates. We give thanks to those who courageously witnessed your liberating love. Free all people from evils of religious strife and hatred. Hear us, O God. Merciful God, your love heals. Care tenderly for all those whose loved ones perish from disease and illness. Strengthen healthcare workers, first responders, and caregivers. Relieve all who mourn with chronic illnesses and pain, especially for Ivan and Evelyn, Nadine, Sylvia, Judy, Susan and David, and any we name before you silently or loud. Hear us, O God. Incarnate God, your love enlightens. Open our hearts and minds to fresh understandings of our faith. Deepen our love for you and for one another. Teach us to pray for our enemies. Hear us, O God. Abiding God, your love saved. Those who died in faith are made alive in Christ. We give thanks for your promise that we will also be raised to newness of life. Hear us, O God. Accompanying us on our journey, God of grace, and receive the prayers of our hearts through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you. Oh.
this holy supper.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took the bread. After he gave thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you and given to you. Do this in remembrance of me. Ministering to you in his name, I give you this bread." In a like manner, after supper, he took a cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me. Ministering to you in his name, I give you this cup." Let us pray the prayer of Jesus for us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Bread for the journey, a feast for hungry hearts. Let us fellowship and come. I invite you to take your cup, remove the top, and release to reveal the wafer. The body of Christ given for you. Of life.
Amen.
Beloved, we are